for inviting me to talk, and for all of you for staying. It's been a long day. It's been a long day for me. My daughter woke up at 2-year-old at 5 o'clock this morning shouting for pineapple. But we only had a banana, so that didn't go down well, too well. So, yeah, thank you for the introduction, Maurice. As she said, I and Rathmel have been involved with the Anstruther survey. It's basically part of a 12-month project, the borough survey itself, within a larger project involving the Townscape Heritage Initiative, and also which is a THR, I think, called the CARS, which is a Conservation Area Regeneration Scheme. THRs are run by, funded by Heritage Lottery funding, and the CARS, the Conservation Area Regeneration Scheme, is funded by Historic Environment Scotland. So the vision for the survey is, it's more than just a history of Anstruther. There's some fantastic books out there. Harry Watson's on Celadyke, Stephen Stevens on Anstruther. So we don't just want to copy what they've done and redo it. It's the aim is that it will be a manual, approachable and usable for everyone, residents, planners, developers, local authorities, to manage the change within Anstruther, Celadyke and Kyoreni. It's also hoped that the project will deliver a legacy of local interest. So out of the projects, mainly the excavation that we've done, other projects might, smaller projects might sort of grow out of that for small community initiatives. I mean, there's a wealth of small community groups within Anstruther, notably the Borough Collection, who do fantastic work on keeping alive the history of the boroughs, but also a very active group within the Improvements Association, to hope maybe undertake smaller schemes of excavation and stuff like that. So it's just a brief outline of what the THRIs are. It basically grew out of Heritage Lottery Fund's desire and want for sustainable conservation in historic urban areas across the UK. In areas that have been, both buildings and areas as a whole, that have been basically let go or been neglected. And then to refurbish these areas and buildings to different uses, either different from what they were, but to try and get them either a community or financial use. With that, again, in the CARS is a scheme just within Scotland that HCS gives to local authorities to regenerate areas or, again, buildings as well. So the buildings that have benefited within Anstruther itself have been the Dual Halls on your left, formerly Hugh Scott Hall or Anstruther West, the church before that, and the Murray Library. So what's happened is, as you can see from the top on the Dual Halls, it's been rehalled, interior work they've done to re-establish the building itself and to also bring it into use. And the kitchen's been updated and the halls have all been revamped. So now it's basically, it's a community hall used by, or run by the Anstruther Improvement Association. A really valuable resource. During the excavation, you realise how many people use it, different groups. We also then came, you know, involved and got talking within the excavation. And then the Murray Library, which was originally for fishermen, which is, that was the start of it, the origins of it. And a huge building, the back of it has been turned into a new business hub, and then the front and the bulk of it now is used as a backpackers hostel. So it's been a great, these have been good, and they've been substantial amounts of work. Nearly 2 or 3 years work on the Jewel Halls, and the Murray Library again was affected by weather in 2015, so that was extended. But they've been a great, great resource, really, really good for the local community. And for us, part of the answer, the work was to increase understanding of the borough's historic environment, the rich heritage that it has, to provide the ability for training within the local community, and to promote to decision makers how important the boroughs are, how significant they have been, and still are, especially within rising with tourism. So I won't go into great detail. I'm sure many of you know what the borough survey series are, but this is what this forms part of. So basically within, you had the intensive redevelopment after the war, especially in the 70s and 80s, of urban historic areas across Scotland. And the small amount of excavations that were done in areas like Aberdeen and Edinburgh demonstrated there was a huge wealth still of medieval, post-medieval finds and artefacts and features. that had been lost and will be lost, were going to be lost. So a more structured approach was needed to make sure this evidence is compiled. So on the back of that, the University Archaeology Department at Glasgow were then asked to undertake the series in the mid-70s, and it was then that basically kick-started the Borough Survey series across Scotland. But the aim was always, even from the early days, was that the series were to provide local authorities, developers, residents and students with reliable information for both research and to help manage and promote the archaeology and historic environment of Scotland's urban areas that was being lost. And I certainly know, talking to within the commercial side, talking to digger drivers who worked in Dundee in the 80s, that the amount of archaeology that they were found and they excavated and then was just told to ignore it and leave it, because it was lost. You know, this is in the time before, you know, we had strict planning permission and protocol for development. So these were key surveys and books that really brought alive and needed the importance to show what was there within these areas. HES, or Historic Scotland and HES at the time, had funded these projects, but unfortunately that stopped. So then what moved was a much more sort of independent approach to Borough Series. And a lot of you probably know the Historic Dunfermline, which has been basically kind of the sort of leading flagships on community involvement within Borough Surveys, and both the historical research and fieldwork participation. So this is kind of our lead, that sort of template that we're basing the publication for the Anstruther Borough Survey. So for ourselves, the promotion of the survey is key. Trying to get local involvement is vital for what we wanted to go ahead. So we had launch meetings, pre-launch meetings. The Harbour Festival was a great way to really get the project out there to those who didn't hear it, who didn't see it, or weren't aware of what we were doing. Posters that were put up around the boroughs. Luckily, we have on the steering group two people, Steve Liscoe, I'm sure a lot of you know, and another little Fiona Mitchell on the council, who were able to put posters up and sort of reach and drum up support. Facebook, which was great, a great resource to stick on things that we were doing, finds that we'd had, especially during the excavation. And then Anstruther Info, which is dedicated to the boroughs themselves, that outlines everything that's going on, some talks coming up, presentations, and enables us to put up short little sort of snippets and notes of what we had done and what also our project historian, Tom Turpin, was doing as well. So also key to this, again, was getting younger audiences participating. So through the Scottish Lyme Centre, we're involved with just a day hands-on session at the Wade Academy, with kids there, mainly 16-year-olds, just have a go at designing their own Mason's Mark. And then they were given a brief outline of what the Mason's Mark is, what it signifies, the origins, what it was used for. So they were just asked basically to have a go. So you see in the middle just some of the ideas that they did. That's me just in the middle of the blue top one. So everyone had a go. And three kids really wanted, they had great support from Wade. They were fantastic, particularly Kenneth Brown, who's one of the teachers there. Who along with myself, were able to sort of get people involved, get the kids involved to come out and to make sure up time on the timetable to come and do it. And then again, next, more volunteer involvement. We carried out archive workshops with, again, our project historian, Dr. Tom Turpin of Stirling University. He got the volunteers to look at primary and secondary sources, a lot of them at St. Andrews University. Again, incredibly lucky, along with East Nuke and Anstruther itself, and both East and Wester and Kilrenny, for the depth of records that you have, early records, you know, town council and privy records, church records, or, you know, Kirk sessions. So, I mean, this is fantastic. We thought we'd only probably get maybe three or four people involved. We got 10 people to undertake six projects in total, with the key aim of that the text that they produce will be used within the publication, and that we can then use build a resource package or resource pack together, which will be stay either within the library or the borough collection, so people later on hopefully again will be a driving sort of force for people to do their own research, and they can use this resource pack and go off and do their own research in different areas that hopefully take their interest and add to it. It's kind of an organic sort of process, if you like. And adding on top of that, so we also had the streetscape assessments, building assessment. So as you can see, the two pictures here are us building specialist Dr. Louise Turner, which was basically going to take people out. We went from, you know, walking around the streets to look at the buildings and assess them, any potential that we could see within them for where they've been changed, there's earlier features and later features that have been amalgamated and moved. So it's all going learning process, training, keeping those people really interested, really looking at their sort of the architecture and the historic environment around them. And that was great. Again, that was a great. We did it over 2 days. And what was great was having the local people with us is that they knew some of the great houses. There's a great lodging just behind us. We were able to go into the house and actually look around the house, which we wouldn't be able to do if we didn't have that volunteer. It was just a professional involvement. So that was a great thing to be able to really properly get to understand. And the people who live in these houses, the gentleman who owns the great lodging was very sort of excited about the way he had regenerated the house. He was very proud of what he had done. He had done it in a very sympathetic and beautiful way. So that was the most important bit. Again, this constant, this push for volunteer involvement. The key, the sort of the flagship, was the community excavation. As a whole, there's been very little work, archaeological work, done within the boroughs. You had a couple of watching briefs within Kilrenny before a modern build of a house. But the largest within Anstruther Easter itself was by Suat in the 90s by Adam Cox. And through this, although they did two hand dug trenches, they found a large, substantial amount of medieval pottery and post-medieval pottery features, walls, drains and wells. So that itself shows the potential for heirs, even though we think it's been built up. I'm sure a lot of you are aware that Anstruther hasn't necessarily expanded, but they've inbuilt over the centuries. So it shows that even though you think it might be lost, there's still stuff lying there that is still to be found. So two sites were proposed by Fife Council, Steve Lisco and Doug Spears. So again, two sites were Jewel Halls and East Brays. They've been informed by previous works and work for the regeneration of the Jewel Halls in this area. If you go there now, you'll see it's all been changed now. And monitoring by Steve Disco in 2012, this area uncovered two or three previously unknown graves. And just to this side, between the glass slab and the tombstone, the tabletop tombstone, was found big, substantial, 3 metres wide, along by about 75 centimetres in width, wall, previously unknown, unrecorded. So that was kind of their interest was, are we seeing this heading on the north side of the nave, going heading east? So that was one of the areas that we wanted to discover. Could we find more of what we knew was an early church existing there, the church or the halls that exist now, remodelled at a later date? And then East Brays was in 96, a gentleman and his son were walking along the coast and a skull was found eroding out of the side of the shore. And so they called the local police, who got in touch with then county archaeologist who did a rescue excavation and just exhumed and removed the top half. As far as we were aware, what we were hoping was that you still had at least either the legs, or maybe some of the pelvis with the legs, just left in. There was no cuts, there's nothing obvious, no grave goods. But it existed at least a good metre and a half down from what was the present soil. So it's in antiquity, we suggest. This is the main, real big involvement. Principally, we want to get the community involved. The excavation is a really good way of getting people involved within the heritage and to understand the evolutions, of their sites and of the area that they live in. So it took, basically it was, we were lucky. We had, I think, one bad day and the rest sunny. This is all done in September, mid-September. And over 3 weeks, a bad day, just on the bottom there. So these are all volunteers, all local within Anstruther, and myself at the top and my colleague Craig Stanford were the ones who provided training. Right. So East Brays, fortunately nothing. Two trenches went in, just under 2 metres wide, and we were probably at least a metre back into the subsoil, into the strata, absolutely nothing. I'm reliably informed, I was easily working at Jewel Horses, it's a lot easier. This was hard digging, it was horrible, it was really heavy and it came down to it. So fortunately, nothing came up there. So then we moved on to the north side of the Jewel Halls. The top left-hand photo there shows a slab where the wall was recovered that Steve Lisco found in his monitoring. So we wanted to stick a trench in, on this one, to, in line with it, see if we could find any follow-up, basically. Nothing. Just what appears to be loose. We thought even maybe it'd been robbed out, but there's no feature cut or anything to suggest there'd ever been a wall there. So we basically scrapped it. It just looks like it's been made ground from remodelling, when the church was remodelled in the mid-19th century. So we cancelled that. That finished within a couple of days. But on the other side, during monitoring in 2014, Steve, the test pit hit the corner, just a very, the large slab stone there, and suggesting it might be kissed. So everything was stopped. excavated now. Unfortunately, nothing. As is always the way quite often. What the picture is, we have no idea. Linear, it looks very artificial, made by human made, if you like, but that was it. The stone was lifted, the slab, it was just sitting on natural, redeposited natural. So, okay, continuing the south side, this is the main, this is the most fruitful area along the footpath. So we started in the trench here, in the foreground, and then moved along the footpath towards east-west, east. And this was really, and this is great. We knew that there was some sort of the earlier church, but where exactly it lay, we didn't know. So we have the path and the well, which we know existed was recorded in the 1850s by the sexton, and was recorded and written by George Gawley in the 1880s in his book. We have a substantial wall here, which fits exactly the same as what Steve was recovering, same width, same use of sandstone, roughly worked and some unworked. Sandstone. That's at the east, within the east end. Just gives you an aerial view of the trench with all the features, the primary main features all in there, with the well, the sandstone footpath, and then the wall coming out. The reason why we chose that, sorry, I should say, is because if you just see the wall, it looks like a buttress coming out there, almost looks like a gable end, and has been like nicely cut off. So that is actually, we now found, would have been the original church wall, and so we wanted to see if we could find the foundations to that, which is what we did, which is the biggest bonus. And then furthest east end was, more the walling and some internal flooring. So, overall, the excavation shows that what we're pretty sure we've got is the 16th century church, early 16th century church. Caroline Mills did dendrochronology work and came back with the date of sort of early 1500s, 1507, 1508. So what we're looking at is basically we have the church is gets too big, possibly looking at the medieval church, gets too big, is expanded to the 16th century church, early 16th century, what we have here. And then basically within the population decreases, the church is then demolished and remodeled in the mid-19th century. But what we have is lovely, the features there themselves. Possibly the stone flooring, which we see the stone path coming in, is maybe a later feature than the wall because the foundations go underneath it. So perhaps the wall put in, and then later a southern axis put in. And the well itself most likely would have been noted as the holy well once blessed and used for baptismal water, washing of communal vessels. That's as much as we can say. It's stone lined, it's a nice shape. The wells along both eastern and western side are a very common feature within the gardens. But it's highly likely that maybe we do have early medieval, or medieval 12th century into 13th century well, which has stayed in existence right the way through. And then without... So that is it. So yeah, great success was primarily volunteer involvement. I think we really had a great uptake and interest from everyone, from all we had young audiences involved, we had sort of middle-aged, everyone, all ages and experiences involved. And that's the base of it. You don't have to have any experience, it's just to get involved, get your hands dirty, if you like. And without that, without the support of all the guests, both the bodies within Anshot itself and the financial support, we couldn't have gone ahead with it. So thank you. So it's a bit rushing as you went so quickly.